walls are like, you know, stacked from floor to ceiling of like bones and skulls and like femurs and stuff. It reminds me of home. No, I'm just kidding. But like, it's just miles of tunnels of, I think it was millions of dead bodies that were stacked on top of each other. And so, if that's not already terrifying enough, there is a story, an urban legend tied to this. So in high school, I learned that not too long ago, there was a man that took his home video recorder, his tape recorder, and he went lyrics, it makes sense, because it says ring around the rosy, and so a rosy was a rash, a symptom of the bubonic plague. So they would show up as like rings all around the body, so like ring around the rosy, and then pockets full of posies. Like posies were actually like herbs that they would carry at the time to like ward off the disease. Ashes is talking about like cremation. And then we all fall down. Like, this is a dark song, you guys. So yeah, basically every time I hear a kid sing that song now, I am going to flat out tell them they are rejoicing in the suffering of millions of deaths back in the bubonic plague. So yeah, I thought that was kind of eerie and bizarre that like all these kids are singing this song about death. Okay, so that was another one. Sorry, I'm trying to like remember what I wanted to talk about. What else? Oh, here's something I find fascinating. So Mount Everest. Yeah, Mount Everest. So over the years, many people have tried to climb to the top of Mount Everest, right? Which is really hard to do, I've heard. No, I'm like, I would never try to attempt something like that, but throughout recent history, climbers have tried to climb Mount Everest and have died in the process because of the intense conditions. After a certain altitude, it gets really cold, the pressure drops, it makes it hard to breathe, all these things, right? I keep saying right, for some reason I'm doing that today, but, people have died trying to climb Mount Everest due to these conditions, and for whatever reason, we keep the bodies, on display. Still, so if you go up Mount Everest, you can actually see like fairly recent dead bodies of climbers that have either frozen to death, they may have fell and broke their leg and just died, but nonetheless you can see these dead bodies like all across Mount Everest as you go up. Now the sick and twisted part of this is that not only are the bodies on display, but they have nicknames. Like, tourists have nicknamed these bodies, which I find so messed up. But like, so you can actually, if you search these, you can actually find these bodies, and then they've all got names, and they're all still there in the position they died in, which is really freaky. But there was one story I was reading in particular that kind of like freaked me out. One of the bodies that actually died in a cave up in the top of Mount Everest had a story behind it. I guess there were some eyewitness accounts of this guy before he died. Some climbers like came back to rescue a guy that had stayed behind. I don't know the full story, but he stayed behind and he actually was like freezing to death. And so some climbers came back to kind of not rescue him because you can't really do anything about it. But they came back and they found him in the cave like freezing, like frozen solid. And they tried communicating with the guy and he was trying to respond, but he was like frozen solid. So literally they were trying to interact with this guy and he was stuck frozen, like mumbling, and it, basically me when my family comes to visit and I'm watching TV, right? So yeah, they were trying to communicate, but he was frozen, and so they left him there and he died, and he's still there, and you can see pictures of this guy, but like just the stories of like them trying to communicate and the eyewitness account of him, like, it's kind of weird. It freaked me out. So that was something I wanted to talk about. What else? Jeez, I hope I can remember all the things. hijacking. And so this was a television broadcast hijack. And if you guys remember, people my age and older would remember this. So television used to be broadcast an analog signal, right? I keep saying right. So anyway, television signal would be broadcast through analog, and then our antennas would pick it up, and then you would watch it on TV. Not too long ago, we actually switched, and television's broadcast in digital now, and that's why we have digital converters to convert it to the TVs. But back in like the 80s, the late 80s, there was a broadcast hijacking, and the thing that blows my mind about this is to broadcast analog signal in the 80s, they had to use massive amounts of equipment, what do you call them? Well, they had to use towers that would broadcast with like these high voltage broadcasting, you know, devices. I can't think of the word, but it was, you know, expensive and really powerful equipment, and somehow somebody hacked one of the TV broadcasts in the 80s. I guess it was during an episode of Doctor Who, and midway through the broadcast, the TV cut out, and it went to static, and then all of a sudden, this hijack, this broadcast that was hijacked, came on the TV. And it ended up being a guy sitting in a room with a Max Headroom mask. And so Max Headroom was like a show in the 80s. This guy did. It was like a comedy show where this guy pretended to be like a computer, and it was like comedic. It was actually brilliant stuff for its time, I think. But anyway, he was wearing this Max Headroom mask. And what makes this broadcast so bizarre to me is that it was set up so precisely. He had like taken this like metal slate and put it behind him, so the background was this like tilting metal slate, and then not only that, but it was staticky and then faint, and he had also took the vocals of the audio and pitched it up and made it into this distorted sound, and he was just like he was talking about nonsense and making random references that the average viewer would have no clue what to make of, and he was just like going on in this mask, and like I can't explain it. Just when you get some time, look up Max Headroom TV hijack. Anyway, so he goes on for a little bit, and then all of a sudden he gets up, and then some like lady bends over behind him, and then he starts smacking this lady in the butt with a fly swatter. I know, it gets intense. So he's like smacking this lady in the butt, and then the hijack, like, and then the broadcast turns to white noise again, and then it goes back to programming normally. I think it was Doctor Who that it was, you know, broadcasting. And the weird part about that hijack is that they have never found the guy who did it. So not only did this guy hijack these really powerful broadcasts, which still blows my mind, and he actually successfully got himself on the air, but they have never found him. They've never been able to track where the broadcast came from, who did it. There's some speculation that it was actually a former employee of the station, and he was just like really mad and just did it out of spite. But I love that. I think it's so interesting. And so that brings me to my next topic, another really interesting broadcast story. Not story, it's like, so basically radio waves, right? So we broadcast radio with different frequencies, FM and AM radio and all these different frequencies, but there's also some shortwave frequencies, there's some other frequencies that are lesser used, but there's like a bunch of radio broadcasts that are being broadcast at these different frequencies, and so one in particular is very fascinating to me. It's called it's a Russian broadcast, and it's called UVB 76. I don't know why they decided to call it UVB 76, as if that isn't like terrifying enough, but it's called UVB 76. It's broadcast. I need to turn my phone on silent. Hold on. Oh god. Okay. Oh gosh. Okay. Sorry about that. I am trying not to make any cuts in this video, but that's not gonna work. So, anyway, it's a broadcast from Russia called UVB 76, and the broadcast has been going on for 40 plus years. So it's a broadcast of a buzzing noise. It's a buzzer that goes on at a steady rate, and that's all this radio station broadcasts, is a buzzer going on and off. And I guess I read that a lot of people think it's the buzzer is being broadcast from a room somewhere, and it's a microphone and a physical buzzer that's and it's just going off into the microphone, and it's been going on for 40 years. That to me is really eerie, that somewhere in Russia there's a room with a microphone broadcasting a buzzer, and it's been going on for that long. And the creepiest part about it is that every so often, like every 10 years or something, some insane amount of time, a voice comes on the radio and starts saying names in Russian, and then starts saying numbers, like random names and numbers, and then it goes away and the buzzer comes back on, and then it keeps going for years and years and years. That is just insane. It like gives me chills to think that that exists. So you can look that up. It's UVB 76. There's also like a bunch more radio broadcasts that are very eerie and like unknown. I actually have a theory on that specific broadcast. I think that it's run by like the military, and I believe, with my very minimal knowledge of radio waves, I think that maybe the military is broadcasting that buzzer at that frequency to kind of preserve a frequency, so when like doomsday hits or something, there will be a free frequency for them to broadcast on or something. So that would make sense, but that's the only way I could rationalize that scenario. So let me think if there's any other topics I wanted to get into. I know so many creepy, eerie stories. Like there's so many really crazy like serial killer stories, and then if you guys haven't like looked them up, there is like a lot of eerie pictures out there, photographs and photography that have like dark stories behind them. There's one I remember. It's this photograph of two kids in a field, and it's like, it's this old photograph, and it's really creepy because of the way it looks. Just the picture is grainy and saturated, and there's these two kids, and their hair is like static, and they're making silly faces or whatnot, and the hair is just static in this field. And what makes it creepy is apparently the story is that that photo was taken like 3 seconds before lightning had struck and killed them, and that's why their hair is like all staticky in the picture. Like, so yeah, that's something else you could look up if you're into this kind of like eerie stuff, is photography with creepy stories behind them. Let me think, is there anything else I want to talk about? I think that's it. I think I'll end it there. So thank you guys for the suggestions. I hope you enjoyed this. best I could to recollect some, I guess I wouldn't call them urban legends, but I think it kind of matches up with that theme, so hopefully you enjoyed that. If you did, let me know. I can do like a series of these. I don't want to like copy Shane or anything, but yeah, I can make like a series of these kind of videos. If you didn't like it, then just tell me so I never do it again. Because I'm already, honestly, I'm creeping myself out. Like, I'm alone in a house and it's dark. And